Now it happened one day that he went out to his father, to the reapers, and he said to his father, my head, my head. So he said to a servant, carry him to his mother. When he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knees till noon and then died. And when she went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God, shut the door upon him, and went out. Then she called to her husband and said, please send me one of the young men and one of the donkeys, that I may run to the man of God and come back. So he said, why are you going to him today? It is neither the new moon nor the Sabbath. And she said, it is well. Then she saddled a donkey and said to the servant, drive and go forward. Do not slacken the pace for me unless I tell you. And so she departed and went to the man of God at Mount Carmel. So it was, when the man of God saw her afar off, he said to his servant Gehazi, look, the Shunammite woman, please run now to meet her and say to her, is it well with you? Is it well with your husband? Is it well with the child? And she said, and she answered, it is well.
Amen.
So speaking of women in unshakable faith, the sub-message is, it is well.
Yes.
Amen.
Now, if you can allow me to just tell the story of the Shunammite woman. The Shunammite woman was a woman from Shunam, and the word said that she was a notable woman. She had influence over people. So the prophet Elijah found himself in Shunam, and this notable woman, they don't even give her name, just that she was a Shunammite. So that woman from Ossining, if you allow me to paraphrase, not even her name, but that she was a noble woman, and she convinced him to come and eat with her. So it was that whenever he was in her town, he would eat with them. So being a faithful woman that she was, she went to her husband and she said, let us build a room for him. Let's build an upper room for him with walls. Let's give him a bed, give him a lamp, give him a chair. So it was that whenever he came there, he would lay there. He would go to their house and he would find rest. So he wanted to honor her faithfulness. So he called to her and he said, what can I do for you? Can I, you know, talk to the king for you? Can I talk to the commander of the army? But she told him she was content. She said, you know, I'm with my people. I'm fine. So she left. But Elisha's servant called to him and said, well, you know, she has no son. She doesn't have a son and her husband is old. So he said, call her back again. So she came and he said, this time next year, you're going to have a son. And her response was, please don't, no, I'm fine. I'm okay. She said, please don't lie to me. And he said, this time next year, you're going to have a son. And it came to pass that indeed, at the time he said, she did have a son. So when I read the text, the child had grew up. They don't say how old he was, but then he grew up, and on this particular day, he had a headache. And he told his father he had a headache. He went to his, the father sent him to his mother, and he sat on his mother's knee and died. Now, I read that and said, my gosh, she sat there and held her child, and her child died. And I would have lost my mind. I think my child, I'm holding my child, and my child died. But she didn't. It said that she went and laid her son in the upper room, in the man of God's room. She didn't take him to his room, her room, she put him in the man of God. To me, it was almost like as if she laid him on an altar. She put him on the man of God's bed. She went to her husband and said, you know, send me a donkey. And he said to her, you know, basically, is everything okay? And she said, it was well. So the text said that when the man of God saw her, he sent his representative to her, and she said, it's well. But when she got to him, it said that she fell at his feet and grabbed hold of him. And Elisha's servant got upset, like, well, she grabbed on, and he said, wait. The man of God said, wait, she's in distress. There's something wrong. And she said to him, basically, Lord, I didn't ask you for this child, but you gave it to me. And now you're taking him away. Like, I don't understand it. You have to bless me. You bless me with this child. Bless his life, Lord. Like, give him back to me. So it said that Elisha took his staff and he gave it to his servant. and he said, go before me and lay, he said, lay it on the child's face.
Yeah.
So he went ahead, so you would think that she would run along with him, but she didn't. She stayed with Elijah, and she said, as the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you. Right. So her faithfulness was just like, I know that my blessing is not with that man, my blessing is here. So it caused Elijah to get up and move on. So the text tells us that he went, and when he got to the house, that the servant said, the child has not awakened. So Elijah went in and said that he put his mouth to the child's mouth, his eyes to his eyes, and his hands to his hands, and he stretched his body out on top of the young man.
Yeah.
It says that his body became warm. He said Elijah walked out, in and out of the house, and he came back. And when he did that, the child sneezed 7 times, he came back to life.
Amen.
And and Elijah called the woman, and he told her to pick up your son. And so she went and she fell on her feet and she bowed to the ground to worship him, and then she went out with her son. She picked her son up and went out. When I read this text, the first thing, I've heard the story before, but there were certain things that jumped out at me. And when I read it, as soon as I said it is well, it was something that moved in my spirit. And I was just like, wow, that's deep. She said, it is well. And then last week, Minister Rodney had said that when he was getting prepared for the his sermon, that it ministered to him first. He said, oh, it ministered to me, and then I ministered to you. That ministered to me because here this woman's child was dead, but she was able to say, it is well. She could have fell out. She could have, you know, recounted the negative story. Oh, my God, my child is dead. But she didn't even do that. She her child and laid it on a man of God's bed. She held it in and got where she was going. She could have stopped and recounted the story, and sometimes we do that. We'll tell a story that's negative, and we'll go on and on and on about it, and it's not doing anything but feeding the negativity. But I said, she said, it is well. Even when his servant came to her and asked her specifically, are you okay? Is your husband okay? Is your child okay? She said, it is well. It was like the word said, you know what, she spoke those things that weren't as though they were. And I said, wow, like, again, her child is dead. And she gets to him and she says, Lord, you gave this child to me. And I started thinking about different circumstances in our life and how sometimes you just gotta know when to just be quiet. Because sometimes mama and daddy don't have the answers. Sometimes your cousin and your girlfriends don't have the answer. Sometimes the only place, and truly, the only place you should be looking for answers is the throne of grace. But sometimes you just got to keep your mouth shut and just get to the altar and pray to the Lord, because that's where your blessing is going to come from. So she knew that. She didn't have time to stop and tell her husband. She didn't want to put that on him. I'm good, is what she said. I'm fine.
Right.
She said that to anybody who crossed her path. But she said, get me to the man of God.
Uh-huh.
And that's how it should be. Get me to this altar.
Yeah.
When my daughter Mackenzie was born, she was born 4 months early. She was 1 pound, 9 ounces, and with a holder like this. She was born at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. We didn't even get a chance to see her. She came out and they zipped her out of the room. We didn't get to see her until the next day at 1 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
All that time, we were just like, you know, the doctors were coming in, sign this form, we gotta give her a blood transfer. Sign this form because this may happen, that may happen. The whole time, they were preparing us for the worst. When I went to go see her, she was, you know, she was in an incubator, her eyes were still sealed, she had a machine breathing for her, she had a machine feeding her, and just laying in there, and I'm saying to myself, Lord, will she even make it? But we just prayed. Before we left the hospital, before my husband came to pick me up from the hospital, the doctor came over to me, and she goes, you know, she has bleeding on the brain, and it's a very severe, so we just want to prepare you because where the bleeding that is usually where the function of speech and everything comes. So she may not speak, she may not walk, but I mean, this is really bad, and I just, you know, it was almost as if I couldn't even receive that message because I'm saying they've been telling us all these bad things. I can't even say, I'm not even going to claim this. Like, I can't claim it. So I never even said anything to my husband. When he picked me up, just continue on. If anybody knows Mackenzie today, Mackenzie will not stop talking. Well, sometimes we'll just say, Mackenzie, please. And she gets so offended. But I said, you know, I thought to myself, like, here it is that they were preparing us saying, she can't speak. But we could have let that, you know, we could have confessed that. We could have been like, well, she's not going to speak.
Right.
She's
right.
not going to speak.
Right.
And you have to be careful with things that you put in the air, things right. that you confess. And we never spoke that. We just, you know, we just continued to pray.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, we're all going through things in our lives. We all have mountains to climb.
Right.
But we don't have to feed into the negativity.
Right. Right.
Even when things look bad, as my husband said in his prayer, God has the final say.
Yeah.
So therefore,
yeah.
we go to him. Sometimes, like I said, you don't have to go to this one or that one. You don't have to go to your friends telling the story. Because why even just put it out there? Just be blessed to say that no matter what it is well.
Yeah.
When I was nervous, I said, I was so nervous that, you know, I contacted the pastor yesterday. And I'm like, well, I didn't get a chance to talk to Sister Katrina. What about the truth, the same person? And we're going back and forth. And she was just like, you know, that's okay, because the Lord's going to give y'all a different way to tell it. But she ended it with, all is well. And I said,
all right.
And I said, it's a sign, like, all is well. And then that text jumped out at me that it is well. And my husband, when he was praying today, you know, he was praying and he was talking about how he had two children that have disabilities. And sometimes it gets overwhelming. But the example that I can follow is the Shunana woman, is that it is well, because you know what, God gave me this child. He gave me these children. And he knew when he gave them, they have special needs. But he said, I'm going to equip you with what you need. I'll surround you with people that will guide you.
Yes.
So in everything that we have going on in our lives, just remember to guard your mouth and just say, it is well. Speak those things into existence, because this woman spoke it into existence. She said, it is well. And at the end of the day, her child lived.
Yeah.
So with that, it is well.
Amen. Amen.